Hope you've had a good week. You know, over the last couple of months, I've been meeting with some of our leaders here to articulate more, you know, who we are here at Green Lane Christian Centre. What's our mission? What's our purpose? What does that mean? You know, where do we go about this mission? And between us, we put together a few sentences that I really love. I think this kind of articulates it really well. I thought I'd share it with you. Is that okay? Hopefully that's a good thing, because this is what we're about. So this is how it begins. This slide up here. Green Lane Christian Centre exists to bring renewal to people and places in the city of Auckland. You've probably heard me say this many times. Our mission here is to renew people and places. The gospel mission, this is what we are about in our city of Auckland. And then there's kind of some strong words that come through in this next sentence. We do this by talking to others about Jesus. Heard that in a few sermons lately, haven't we? You know, we need to talk about Jesus, living the values of the kingdom of God, values like the ones that are on our wall in front of us, challenging unjust and damaging practices. Lots of things that, you know, need to be corrected and renewed around us, and proactively helping to rebuild what's broken. A lot of brokenness in our world, in our homes. And in fact, that goes on to talk about where we will do these things, where we will talk and live and challenge and help in the communities God has placed us within. It's our homes, because our homes are broken places so many times, and renewal needs to happen. In our schools, in our clubs, in our workplaces, you know, we will, again, talk about Jesus. We will live out these values. We will challenge. We will help. And in our neighborhoods, right where we live. You know, this is what we are about. Why we get out of bed every single morning. This is what mobilizes us. The gospel and mission is what has driven our church these past 35 years. It's in our DNA, fabric of our being, must always be, always will be, at least while I'm around. And I just love what God is doing among us. So as a senior team, we're in the process of putting some shape, I guess some skin around some of the implications of that to our ministries right here as a church. And I am so excited about what the Spirit of God is doing in this season of Green Lane Christian Centre. You know, as you know, we've been just finished this 25-week series in the Gospel of Luke. And we're about to kick off a new series, which is in the Minor Prophets, a kind of set of books that actually a lot of us probably ignore because we just get a bit confused about them, or we think the minor part means they're not all that important, which is wrong. But there's something so much I want us to see in these about the mission of God and what it means for us to be launched and mobilized to actually renew people and places in our homes, in our clubs, in our workplaces, in our neighborhoods. But before we get there, before we kind of jump into another, you know, lengthy series, I thought it'd be good to take a week or two out to talk about serving, especially serving within our church. And I do this unapologetically, really for three reasons. For one, a particular phrase you'll probably hear me use a bit this morning, that a healthy, thriving church is not built on the talents and gifts of the few, but on the sacrifice and service of the many, or of the everybody. That's really the first reason. Because if we are actually going to embrace and fulfill this mission of renewing people and places, it involves all of us. Second reason I'm unapologetic about, you know, today's topic is because a lot of us here, I think, really want to have that sense of belonging as a church community. See, it's really easy to come along to a large church like this, come along to a service, and really remain anonymous if you so choose. And some of you think, you know, there's kind of no need for you to serve or no need for you to contribute. A lot of you hold back thinking, well, you know, I look at these other people who are up the front, or these people I hear about and I see what they do. I can never do that. Or perhaps I'm not really needed here at all. And so you kind of remain anonymous. And it's kind of like you're an observer in the sports stand. You know, you come along to a game, you choose a seat, you know, you grab your popcorn and drink, and you sit back and you watch others play on the field. And from time to time, you might even, you know, cheer people on. But the game isn't played, you know, in the stands. It's played on the field. And I notice that in people's language, because sometimes they'll talk about, you know, that church or your church, but there's no sense of belonging, even when they're fans. The place we all need to be, of course, is right on the field, in the heart of the action. Moving from spectators to actually team members engaged on the mission field together. And it's right there that we develop this great sense of belonging. It becomes our place. And we move from talking about your church or that church to my church. It's part of us. That's why I'm going to be talking about serving today. Not only is it a part of our mission, or fix our mission, not only does it give us this great sense of belonging, we also need to talk about it because, well, God's word is really clear about the need for us to serve. So let's open God's word. Allow the Spirit of God to speak to us today about this matter of serving. This is what we read from 1 Peter chapter 4. God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to serve one another. Do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God himself was speaking through you. Do you have the gift of helping others? Well, do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. Then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. Well, glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. From these verses, I want to make three simple observations that are really clear from God's word. First observation here is that God has given every follower of Jesus a spiritual gift. So whether you've been following Jesus for 50 years or for 5 minutes, you've been given at least one spiritual gift. Now, if you've grown up in, you know, kind of church life, you're probably familiar with that language of spiritual gifts. But if this is kind of new to you, as it is to some of you here, you know, it might sound a little weird. So let me kind of illustrate what's happening here. On your seat when you came in is a card. If you could, you know, pick this up, hold it in your hand, be familiar with it for a tick. There's a piece of music there, and then at the very end of it is one of the verses I just read, that God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. You might need to wear really magnifying glasses to read it, but it's right there. On the other side is a picture, and there's at least 12 different cards out there. 8 of them have instruments on them, 4 of them have kind of a vocal range, and all of those instruments and vocal, you know, groups are what plays this music here of Handel's Hallelujah Chorus from the Messiah. So I want to kind of use this as an illustration of how spiritual gifts are meant to work. So think of this as the moment you've received your gift. And your gift is right there on the card in front of you. I've got the violin on this card right here. So let's say you have the bassoon. How many of you have the bassoon? We'll put a picture up here so you know at least what it looks like. If you've got the bassoon, can you stand up for a moment? There's going to be others too. Yeah, great. So these are our bassoon players. Let's say that they're gifted by God as bassoon players. Now, I needed to know what that actually sounds like. So I went online. Here's what it's, just stay standing. Here's what it sounds like in the Hallelujah Chorus to play the bassoon. Yeah, so pretty good. Hey, we can kind of appreciate our bassoon players. You guys did a great job. Now, some of you have a vocal range of sopranos. You know, those kind of high notes. If you've got a soprano gift, let's kind of stand up, at least on your card. It doesn't have to be in reality, just on your card. Stand up. So there's a lot of guys. there we go. So you're able to hit the high notes today. You've always wanted to do this, haven't you? Always wanted to do this. This is what it sounds like in the Hallelujah Chorus. Yeah, well done. Particularly you guys among us that you could actually deliver on that one. Pretty impressive. Now, we won't do this for all of them. You kind of get the idea. You know, but there's 8 different instruments and four different, you know, vocal ranges all coming together in this hallelujah, you know, piece from Handel's Messiah. All different gifts, all spread among us. Now, question, did any of you earn these gifts this morning? Of course not. You know, you just came along and whatever was on your seat, you know, is your gift. And this is really how the Spirit of God works among us. He sovereignly, at his discretion, gives a gift of his choosing to every single believer. And that's why Peter here uses that word gift. The original word in kind of the Greek language is this word, the same root word for grace, charis, from which we get charisma, charismata. So it's like, you know, just with salvation, we don't do anything to be saved. We receive it as a gift, these spiritual gifts, the same way are given to us by the gracious and sovereign will of God. In fact, even when we talk about spiritual gifts, the word spiritual isn't actually in the original language. We kind of insert it in English so that we all know that we're talking about something different from, you know, presents we might receive at birth, you know, for our birthday or Mother's Day or Christmas or something like that. These are traits, these are skills. It's kind of a knack of some sort that God gives to every single believer. Now, the Bible talks about these spiritual gifts in four places in the New Testament. I find them kind of easy to remember where they are because two of them have the, you know, are kind of a chapter 12, you know, Romans chapter 12 or 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And then two of them have a chapter 4 next to them. So Ephesians chapter 4 and 1 Peter chapter 4, which is our passage here this morning. And the thing I find interesting in these four different places is that there's a different list of gifts in each of these, which kind of tells me that the list isn't exhaustive. And in fact, even if you bring all of the list together from all of these places, I don't think it's meant to be the comprehensive list of spiritual gifts that we might have available to us today. The idea rather is that the Spirit gives every follower of Jesus at least a trait or skill, whatever that skill and trait is that the church, the local church community needs in order to fulfill its mission. And even people that have the same gift, you know, same instruments or whatever that is, you know, probably even play a little bit differently. Over the last few weeks, you've probably seen an illustration of that even in the different communicators we've had up front. So Mick Duncan, Sarah Harris, and myself all communicate, I think, very differently from each other. And yet the Spirit of God gives a gift, the way that's packaged, the way it's presented can be quite different, which I think is a really, really good thing because if he didn't do that, there wasn't such diversity. I think it could be quite boring. But God in his wisdom and in his beauty makes everybody so different. And the way all of these gifts are even packaged is so different from each other. It's a good thing. So here in our text in 1 Peter 4, Peter highlights two different groups of gifts. Speaking and serving. By speaking, I guess he could mean things like prophecy and glossolalia and teaching and evangelism. Perhaps you could add to that list things like singing or sharing words of praise or testimony. It's not kind of the casual chit-chat we might have among us, but this is a kind of a special enablement, special gift that the Spirit of God gives to different people that has kind of a verbal dimension to it. And he talks here about another category, serving. I guess it's the deeds that the one Christian does for another, the way they care for the poor and the sick. Healing, administration, serving on tables, bringing God's love and care in concrete forms. Now, a lot of us, all of us are called to do some of these things as well, but these people seem to have a particular knack that when they do it, you just sense that God is present. God is the one who chooses, though, which gift everybody has. That's the first observation from God's word I want us to really be clear of. God has given every follower of Jesus a spiritual gift. There's another observation I see here. These spiritual gifts are to be used to serve one another. It's as clear as you can get. Peter says, use them well to serve one another. See, oftentimes when we talk about spiritual gifts, I think we start to get confused. And we start to think they're actually for us. And there's obviously some benefit to us. But I was kind of laughing to myself just at the beginning of the service. My kids were up the front, and you can always tell my kids because they're the loudest, most active kind of kids around the place. And they're up here, and they saw the cards on the seat. So their intention was they recognized that they're all kind of different cards. So they started to go around the seats and try to, you know, kind of these collector's cards that they wanted to kind of have all of them, you know, in a little collector's piece. And I kind of wonder if that's what we often do when it comes to this topic of spiritual gifts. We kind of want to have this, you know, collector's piece. We want to like spotlight them a little bit. And these are the gifts I have. And if we kind of stop there, we've kind of missed the point, isn't it? Because Peter says that the reason God has given them to us is for the benefit to help one another. So he says here, do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God himself was speaking through you. You know, be careful with the gift. Treat it well, particularly if you have a role or responsibility that comes with it. This is something that's been especially entrusted to you. So have some humility along with that gift. The idea is that if you can sing, God has gifted you in that way. You know, don't just sing in the shower, you know, to yourself. But, you know, sing so that other people can benefit from the gift that you have. Then he goes on. Do you have the gift of helping others? And we do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. His point is that, you know, gift isn't to be left in some cupboard of our lives, you know, we're collecting dust. It's to be exercised, employed for the benefit of others. Now, I think there's lots of reasons why people don't serve others with their gifting. It might be that you don't know what your gift is, or what opportunities there might be where you can use that gift. You don't know how to kind of begin that journey of, you know, using your gift to serve others. And we'll talk more about that next week. Some of you, I'm guessing, have probably also had some bad experiences where a church has, you know, spoken about spiritual gifts and then kind of grabs you and kind of slots you in something that really isn't you at all and you can't stand it. Or you come to a big church and you think, well, I'm not really needed here, or I couldn't, you know, do things at the level it kind of needs to be at. But remember, a healthy, thriving church is not built on the talents and gifts of a few, but on the sacrifices and the service of the many. So again, let me illustrate this with the cards that we have in front of us. You know, when I played some of those instruments earlier, they sounded okay by themselves, didn't they? But, you know, maybe a little bland. Let's go back and actually play the bassoon again to kind of remind you what that sounds like. Now, you know, it sounds pretty good. So well done, you know, bassoon players among us. But, you know, to be honest, I don't think I'd be paying money to go hear Handel's Messiah if it was just bassoon players. You know, it almost sounds like the bassoon players are just getting really exhausted trying to carry the whole orchestra and convey something, and it's just the group of, you know, little group of bassoon players and not the whole orchestra. You know, and it would be like, you know, if I tried to play all the instruments at once and sing in all those ranges from soprano right down to bass, I don't think any of you would be paying to come along to hear that unless you wanted to make just sheer mockery of what I was doing. It doesn't have the same magnetism to it. But something pretty powerful happens when every single person engages, when every single person uses the gifts they have to be part of something bigger and to serve one another. So when you take these 8 different instruments and these 4 different vocal types, and everybody comes together and they hit the right keys and they hit the right notes at the right time and the right way, something very special happens. Listen. Thank you. And you get to the end, and you just like want to like jump up and start cheering, don't you? Because it's just, you know, when everybody plays, the results are breathtaking. Now, when we all engage, when we all risk, when we all give it a go, something special happens among us. Something kind of magnetic that kind of draws us all together. I want to be part of something just like that. I want to be part of something magnetic. I want others to stop what they're doing and listen and be drawn to the music we create. I want to enjoy the harmony of it all just coming together beyond what one person could possibly ever try to do and produce by themselves. And I think all of us actually want to be part of something that has that magnetism to it. But for that to happen, we need to move from just a few people serving to everybody engaged. We need to move beyond the idea of such things to the practice of these things and involve us all taking a step. It might even get a bit messy, a bit confusing as we try to discover what all of this looks like and how we do it all. As we effectively open our lives to the winds of the Spirit and we step out into some, you know, maybe some risky terrain and allow the Spirit of God to guide us and lead us towards something big and grand and dynamic. This leads us to the final observation here in the passage. You see, when we use these spiritual gifts to serve one another, God is put in the spotlight. That's how Peter finishes his passage. Then, you know, when you serve one another, then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. All glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. I guess it's appropriate, isn't it, that we use Handel's Hallelujah chorus, because the word hallelujah comes up in his song 167 times. People talk about repetition in today's songs. I mean, way back then, you know, 167 times, same word over and over. And it's an amazing thing. When we use our gift to serve one another, God's glory, his reputation is revealed, it's enhanced. People come to know Jesus by the way we all pitch in to serve. And you're part of the journey for someone to know Jesus. You'll hear somebody say, you know, God spoke to me today when you were doing your thing. People sense the tangible presence of God because of the way you served. You'll hear them say things like, I sense God's love like I never have had that experience before. I felt included. I came today without hope, but now I have hope. All because you spoke, all because you served. Something powerful happens in that space. I love the way the Apostle Paul develops this further at the very end of the book of Romans. When people think about the book of Romans, they often think of it as this meaty book with all these theological truths, and it's true, it has all of that. The very last chapter of Romans is probably ignored by most people. I want to highlight it a bit because I think it's really important what Paul says in that last chapter about our topic right here. Listen to the way he writes. I commend to you our sister Phoebe, who's a deacon in the church in Cenchrea. Welcome her in the Lord as one who is worthy of honor among God's people. Help her in whatever she needs, for she's been helpful to many and especially to me. You see, we often hear about Paul, you know, guru, you know, leader, amazing guy. Not so much about Phoebe, but Paul wants to put her in the spotlight. He says, give my greetings to Priscilla and Aquila, my co-workers in the ministry of Christ Jesus. In fact, they once risked their lives for me. I'm thankful to them, as so are all the Gentile churches, and give my greetings to the church that meets in their house. This is the way they're serving. Greet my dear friend, Epaphroditus. This is the first person from the province of Asia to become a follower of Christ. I've never heard of him. We tend to skip these parts. Don't know, don't care, you know, move on. You know, we know about Paul, leader extraordinaire. Lots of people wanted to get engaged around him. We hear about Paul, but the point Paul's making is there's a whole team of people serving alongside of him that we often don't hear about. Keep reading. Give my greetings to Mary, who has worked so hard for your benefit. Greet Andronicus and Junia, my fellow Jews who are in prison with me. In other words, you know, Paul, when he was writing this, was under house arrest. And there's two people here he speaks of that voluntarily put themselves under house arrest to help Paul in spreading the gospel. Never thought about them before. A lot of people wanted to be around Paul when things were sweet, but most gave up when it involved some suffering. He goes on. These other names, greet Ampliatus, my dear friend in the Lord. Greet Urbanus, co-worker in Christ, my dear friend Starshes. Goes on. Greet Apelles, a good man whom Christ approves. Give my greetings to the believers from the household of Aristobulus. Just name after name after name after name. And I often hear again, people talk about the meat in the book of Romans, but they tend to ignore what I think is the meat in Romans chapter 16. Where Paul really is making the point, the church is not built on the talents and gifts of a few, but on the sacrifices and the service of the many. Give my greetings to Asyncritus, Philegon. I can't even pronounce all these names. Hermes, Patrobus, you know, name after name. Goes on and he talks about the scribe who wrote these truths down, the people who delivered his letter to others. I guess in today's modern context, it would be people like people in the sound booth, people on the visual desk, people who upload, you know, messages on the World Wide Web. You know, all these different people who might not be known and seen, but they enable the gospel to be heard, articulated, delivered. And all these names we can skip over. Whole chapter in this most amazing book, you know, meaty, helping remind us that it was this partnership of all these people coming together to deliver the gospel and the mission, and that through that, everybody was mobilized and renewal was brought to their cities. It's almost like Romans 16 is like the revolving credit at the end of a movie. And we go to the movie because we know some of the, you know, the hot shots and big name actors in the movie, and we go along and we almost like to like turn it off at the end, don't we? But when you stop and notice, it's like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people involved in producing and directing and making that movie. And that's what Paul's doing here. It was a highlight. You know, a whole community of people is involved in the mission of God to be accomplished. And that's why Paul is at pains to stake. And then he finishes and he highlights, just like Peter does, what happens when we all pitch in and serve. Same way God is glorified. He says, now all glory to God, who was able to make you strong, just as my gospel, the good news says. This message about Jesus Christ has revealed his plan for you Gentiles, a plan kept secret from the beginning of time. But now as the prophets foretold, and as the eternal God has commanded, this message is made known to all Gentiles everywhere, so that they too might believe and obey him. All glory to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. You see, the reason God is glorified and the reason this message got out is because person after person after person served and engaged. They spoke and people heard the message. They served and people found hope when they had hopelessness before. They found tangible expressions of God's presence among them. Now, I want to kind of pause here for a moment and chat to a few people right here at GCC to help us see how this looks right here at Green Lane Christian Centre. So if I can invite right up to the front, Zephyr to grab a seat just over here, and Rodney, John, and Maria, if you can come up to the front as well. Let's give them a big welcome as they come up. Okay, so Zephyr, let me kind of begin with you. So you're studying at the moment, right? So tell us a little bit about, you know, what you're studying, what you hope to do in the future.
Okay, so I'm Zephyr, I'm 20 years old, and I'm studying urban planning at Auckland University. And so I design cities, and I'm on my third year, so I'm very excited to just finish it all next year, and yeah.
So you're kind of renewing people and places.
I work with people and places. So it's like placemaking, and it incorporates a lot of different areas, like, you know, social planning and like design and economics and planning law and environmental law. So that's what I do.
Yeah, it's exciting. How long have you been part of Green Lane Christian Centre?
I first came to GCC last year in February. Actually, a friend invited me. I used to live in Ellerslie, and I would always catch the train there to school in uni. And at the back of the building, it has the Green Lane Christian Center tag. And so I've always wondered, what it really is the difference between Christianity and Catholicism? Because back then I was a Catholic. I come from Philippines, and so 95%, 98 even, of the people there are born Catholics. And so I come from a very staunch Catholic family, and I was following the religion of my family, but faith wasn't personal to me. It didn't really click for me. Like, I knew they had instilled that fear of God, but, you know, I was following it blindly. And yeah, you know, I knew there was God, I knew Jesus, but I didn't have the knowledge of the Bible, and so I didn't have the truth. I didn't know that God hates idols. Basic truths like Jesus is the only mediator between man and God. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through this one man, and his name is Jesus. So even that I didn't know. It's like I was blind, but now I see. And
talk about songs today, yeah.
Yeah, we're talking about songs today. And it wasn't until I came to first year uni that I met a Christian friend, and it just so happens that he also comes to GCC, so I asked him, can you take me to church one night? And that night, you were actually talking about your message, and it was titled Circumstances That Deepen. And the message was that we come through circumstances in our lives that either keep us moving forward towards God or, you know, backtrack us. We choose to go our own way. And because I didn't know the Bible back then, I didn't have any grounding of what the truth was. Before I was a Christian, I had missed out on this like really huge scholarship to pay for all my student loans and everything. And I thought that I had done everything I could to accomplish that. You know, I did the sacraments, I prayed, and I did everything. It was through works. But I didn't know that. Well, I guess I didn't want God's plan, and I wanted my own will. And so that night, I accepted Jesus into my life. That, you know, I learned he's going to take everything away from you, or like the most important thing that you think you need, so that you can know that God is God, not your wishing well. God is the taker and giver of your everything. So you're not equal. He's your master. He's your Lord. And I guess that put me in my place, and I accepted Jesus as my Savior and Lord.
Yeah, fantastic. So that was February last year.
Yeah.
What happened after that night?
So after that night, I knew that I wanted to belong to GCC. Like, this is my home church. You know, I attended Starting Point, and they linked me to Alpha.
Just tell me a little bit. Tell us what Starting Point is.
Yeah. So Starting Point is anybody who are new here to Green Lane Christian Center or fairly new here. So you can get to know the people who, you know, are behind the scenes. They introduce themselves to you, and you know, they get to know more about you as well. They introduce who they are from the different ministries that are here and what they do, and they also talk about, you know, the values and the mission statement that the church has. So you get a grounding of who we are as a community and what we do here and what we'd like to do to renew people and places.
You're promoting this really well. Well done. So you went to Starting Point,
yeah.
and then what happened in the next step?
So the people there, they linked me to Alpha, and I enjoyed Alpha. I did it for, I don't know, 4 months. And basically, I really enjoyed it because as a new Christian, I had so many questions of, it was like a transition time from coming from Catholicism to Christianity. I had so many questions about who the God of the Bible really was. Like, yeah, he's the God of life and love, but, you know, he's also the God of judgment. There's so many more truths out there that I didn't know about the God of the Bible. And so it was a safe space for me to ask questions. There were also people there who were non-Christians in my group. And, you know, it was inviting. It was safe. It was, you can ask anything. And there were people there who were really keen to help you and guide you to Jesus Christ. So
Zephyr, then last year you made the decision, if I remember, to get baptized.
Yes, that's right.
But that wasn't like an easy decision for you either.
No, yeah. No, it wasn't. So February I came to GCC. September I got baptized. I knew I wanted to get baptized. It was hard, but it was also easy because, first of all, I love Jesus Christ. It's God's command that we get baptized. It's not an option. We're commanded to be baptized because we want to express what's happened inside of us. It's really God, you know, working in our lives. It's to his glory. And it was difficult because my family didn't agree. And like I said before, they were staunch Catholics, and they had the mindset that we were born as Catholics, we're going to die as Catholics. So it was kind of hard to get past that. And also, I'm the youngest in our family. And so it's kind of like, you know, who are you to, you know, kind of tell us we're wrong in everything that we've taught you. And so that was difficult to kind of break the mold in my family. So whether or not they agreed or not, I was still going to get baptized. So before I got baptized, I was given an ultimatum that I could either stay home and be a better Catholic, or I could leave. But, you know, as Jesus says in the gospel, he warned us that we're going to have tribulations in this world and that not everyone is going to agree with the hope that we have in him. And so the cost of even following him, or like discipleship, you have to carry your cross each day, and we're ambassadors of Christ, and so we're going to be experiencing things like this. And you know, I knew what I was doing. It was difficult, but like he said, you got to come out, my people. And I got baptized, and I took my sister with me as well. So she got baptized last week, and she started coming here at the start of the year. So, yeah.
So you started coming February last year.
Yeah.
You came to know Jesus
that
Sunday night. You joined Starting Point. You know, involved in Alpha, growing. Then you get baptized. You invite your sister, I think, that night.
Yeah.
And then she becomes a follower of Jesus, and now baptized last Sunday night.
Yes.
Oh, wow. That's pretty exciting, isn't it, over the course of the last, just over the year. Well, now, also got, as you noted, a few people up here as well. So if you can introduce yourselves with a little bit of what you do through the week, a little bit of your family, how long you've been here at GCC.
My name is John. I've been coming here for 10 years. We have 10 beautiful grandchildren spread around the world, and I've been in the property business all my life. So.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Maria. I am married to Robert. He's probably washing dishes in the kitchen. We have 4 children and 1 grandchild, and we've been coming here for maybe about 20 years now.
Yeah.
One will do. My name is Rodney. I'm married to Dinah. We have 3 adult sons, Anthony, Jason, and Elliot, and we've been coming to Green Lane for the best part of 33 years.
Yeah, wow. Wow, 33. Yeah, wow.
A bit longer than Jonathan.
So, Ronnie, starting with you, you know, there's been a whole lot of different areas you've served in, but tell us where you're serving right now and why you're serving there.
Okay, well, it's been a privilege to be part of the Alpha Ministry, and I've been doing it for close to 20 years, and wow. I thought I'd be in for 1 year, but ended up staying for 20, mainly because that's where I believe God wants me to be at the moment. And although I've done various things within the Alpha Ministry, currently I'm more involved with the support base, It's just to oversee the whole running of the network, I guess, make sure that all the hosts and helpers are equipped as much as possible, make sure that everything runs smoothly. Apart from welcoming the people and doing some teaching and training, I try to have a background role only so that the hosts and helpers get to spend more time with the most important people, and that is the guests.
But officially, you know, you're the leader of Alpha here at GCC, and you pull the team together and create the culture and all of that, and do some teaching from the front. Yeah, this is the way you serve.
Yes.
Yeah. Maria, tell us a little bit about how you serve and why you serve in that way.
I've been serving in different areas in GCC in the past. However, at the moment, I'm part of the Alpha Group, like Rodney. And so I've been serving in Alpha since 2005 when I first did the Alpha course, and I felt like it was the perfect place to come and serve and use the gifts, the abilities that I have, because I've been serving in the kitchen, doing dishes or help serve out the food. I've been singing in the band. It's not a gift, but it's I can sing. And also being part of the small group. Now, with the small group, I've been either help facilitate the discussions or just being there, making the guests or the people that come to do Alpha feel comfortable, feel welcome, and just serve them by maybe taking their dishes to the sink. And even when we go away on the weekend away, which is the highlight of Alpha, it's really a time where your spiritual gifts are used for those people who have come to do Alpha, because you get to pray with them, pray for them, tell them more about the Christian faith, and just seeing their lives transformed, and see God coming and becoming so real in those people's lives. It just makes what you do well worth it.
Yeah.
Part of the voluntary team in the kitchen, and basically I just turn up and do as I'm told. It is gratifying though, because you could be doing anything from dishes to preparing your food, and we do prepare a very nice meal and do everything we can to make them feel welcome, because they're most of the non-Christians, and I think it's very valuable.
So what I'm doing here, if you haven't kind of picked it up, it's kind of like what Paul's doing in Romans chapter 16. He's just told the story of how people come to know, with all these great theological truths around that, how people come to know Jesus and engage and learn, and these are the great theological truths. But there was a spotlight on a whole bunch of people who are serving to actually make that happen. And so, you know, Alpha being a big part of Zephyr coming to grow in her faith, and then for Iris to come to know Jesus, and now Iris been involved in, I think, Maria and your group, right, that you're hosting. So, and this is just some of the people involved. You know, as Rodney speaks and leads, as Maria, you know, facilitates and hosts, you know, people like Iris in a group, and Zephyr earlier in the group, you know, and John, you know, serving in the kitchen, just making sure all these different places around hospitality are actually being taken care of. You know, it's almost like, you know, you can almost think of all these other names that were part of Zephyr's story as well. So, you know, the first Sunday, you know, or should we go back, you know, seeing the banner outside and knowing this was a church, and then talking to a friend who she knew came to GCC, you know, so he's talking about that. Her coming, I mean, she hears me preach, but she only heard me preach because there's people at the booth with the sound disc and the visuals. And that very night, there were people making coffee, just creating a lovely atmosphere. There were about five people in the worship team. There were people after the service. We can talk about starting point and the way people like Emily and Tammy were serving to create that kind of space to know, well, what does it mean to belong here as a church? We can talk about all the other people involved in Alpha. There'd be another couple of dozen people. Everybody involved, playing their role so that there could be this sense of somebody coming to know Jesus, growing in their faith so that God is glorified, his reputation is heard all around the place. You know, you see, this is what I love. You know, there's double bass players, there's soprano players, all these different people doing their thing so the great song comes together. And that's what I want to see more of here as a church community. It's happening a lot already, but imagine what it looks like when all of us get involved in serving in some way. And if you don't know what your gift is and how to engage and all those type of things, we'll talk more about that next week. But I think it's at the moment, it's just about all of us taking some time to pray and explore, God, what is your spirit saying to me at the moment about where I'm at and what I need to do? You know, talk to other people in your small group. There's different activity you can do this week to help you in that. But I think, isn't it the story? It's incredible. But what God has done through the service of the many to enable this to happen. Can we appreciate our panel this morning? Thank you. You know, as I wrap up the talk, came across a story this week of a man who was staying at a hotel in Norway in the middle of the 19th century. And he came out of his hotel room and he heard this young girl playing the piano, really kind of trying to play the piano downstairs. And was playing, he says, oh, it's terrible noise, just plink, plonk, plink, plink, plonk, you know. And then another man came up next to her and he didn't stop what she was doing. She was still doing her, you know, plink, plonk, plink, plink, plonk. And then he just started to play just kind of around her, you know, adding in a few notes. He says, this is most profound music, such beautiful piece. And he discovered that the guy that sat next to her was the girl's father and that this was actually one of the famous Russian composers called The Five, Alexander Borodin. I wonder if that's what happens when we serve. By itself, at times, it might just sound a bit like plink, plonk, plink, plink, plonk. And yet as other people come around, as other people join in with their gifts and they play the right notes at the right time, I think there's this beautiful sound begins to form and the gospel is seen and the gospel is heard in dynamic ways. And when that happens, the results are breathtaking. And we get to experience the music. Let's pray together. Jesus, thank you that you have gifted every single one of us. Do you want us to be all part of this grand orchestra and choir that proclaims your mission, lives out your mission in our homes and workplaces and clubs and neighborhoods? And God, help us to do that. Help us to hear from your Spirit about what you'd be saying to us today about serving. Might have a lot of questions in front of us, but Jesus, would you guide us by your Spirit? Whether it's encouragement and affirmation, a challenge to take some next steps. Help us to even step into what might be messy. Give us the courage that we need. Help us to all learn how we need to play and hit the right notes and keys to be part of something that dynamic, this dream that you have for us as a church. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.